brother, there's no other.
Jesus is the way.
Is the only way.
Jesus is the answer of the world today.
Yeah.
Glorify the name of God for the special opportunity for us to be blessed this evening again. This is your favorite program, Kingdom Life, coming to you from your inspirational station, Echo 89.7 FM. I'm Jumi Adetu Ishon Lagunju, the minister on this program. The Lord has been using this program to bless millions of people out there. Marriages have been restored, wounds have been healed, challenging situation in the life of the young adults have been brought to a very wonderful testimony situation. And for as many people out there, even people in prison, they have received divine favor. They have received peace of mind. And some people that are hopeless out there in the society, they have seen the unfailing hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Many people are being healed of their ailment. Not because of how much they contributed to this program. It is simply how well they believe in that word of God. The reassurance coming from this episode, from this program, that God loves them, He cares for them. According to the faith you have in our Lord Jesus Christ, He is going to deliver you tonight. According to the belief you have that yes, your situation is already receiving attention, testimony will continue to abound in your life. My dear listener out there, please, you have nothing to lose by coming to this our Lord Jesus Christ, by simply putting your trust in Him. As you do so, great will be your testimonies in Jesus' name.
Amen.
My dear listener out there, as I said earlier on, I'm Jumi Adetu Ishon Lagunju. I'm not alone in the studio tonight. I have with me my co-presenter, Sister Lua Fumilayo. You are welcome to the program tonight.
Good evening, listener.
Thank you very much. My dear listener out there, I know God loves you. He cares for you. In the last few episodes, we have been looking at a series of messages on God's expectation from parents to the children. And we look at examples in the scripture, and precisely we look at Joseph, how as a teenager he found himself in a strange land where they don't even worship God out there. But because of the foundation he had from the early stage, from his parents, he was able to live with reference to God in everything he did, the way he relates with people, his integrity, and his reference to God in challenging situations, putting his trust and hope in Him, and not allowing the influence of the world out there to make him to miss his step. And now that Lord favored him in everything he did. And we encourage us that please, as we keep on putting our trust in Him and putting our faith in Him, we will continue to have testimonies to share. We also saw out there how everything he did was prospered, how everything he touched was successful because of the divine favor from above. And we assured us that whatever our children are, the one we are bringing up, wherever they go, that uncommon favor will continue to be with them. Also encourage us that as you invest in them at this early stage, what they will continue to have is, they will continue to be for signs and wonders, and testimonies of that Lord's goodness will be flowing into our life through these children in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So my dear listener out there, I want to believe we have started it. Even if you are yet to get married, you are yet to have a family of your own, children of your own, the Lord is equipping you up front. And for we that are already in the business, He will empower us. He will give us that wisdom and understanding to do it. And if relationships have been strained between parents and the children out there, even the children have left home, you are even saying you can't forgive them again, the Lord is bringing that healing tonight for total restoration and for your joy to be continue to be full in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So my dear listener, you are welcome once again to the program. This evening, we are looking at a key part, a concluding part of the previous episode, where Joseph showed that uncommon love to his brothers. And in that area of forgiveness, they thought, humanly speaking, he will not be able to forgive them. And they started trying to fashion out some ways of appease him, to appeal to him that, please, our father said this. Whereas the father did not send them. The father died. And because the father had sown that seed in Joseph before, about that reference to God in whatever he did, Joseph said in that concluded part of chapter 50 of Genesis that, am I in the position of God that you are begging me now? No. Whatever you have done, which to you is evil, the Lord has turned it to be good for me. In fact, it's God that brought me here to be a blessing to other people. And we are told in that last verse that he spoke kindly to his brother. I love the way the scripture put it. He spoke kindly to his brother. He treated them well, and even their own family. Ha, ha, ha. Hey, I know some people. If somebody offend them, and he even came to apologize. Oh, the harsh word that will come out. Wonderful. The harsh word, you will be wondering, are you God? But Joseph is saying, I'm not in the position of God. I've forgiven you. Not only, it's not even for me to forgive. It's God that forgives. And who am I? I'm just alive today. What if tomorrow life ends? Will I still go with that same anger? No, he said, I've forgiven you. Not only that, he spoke kindly to them and took care of their family. The Lord is reminding you and I, go and do likewise. I should go and do likewise and do as he has done, as he has laid example for us. So today we'll be looking at this message on the way God sees sinners, or the way God sees those who offended us. The way God sees sinners and the way God sees those who offended us. We quoted one of those phrases by Mahatma Gandhi, and I want to believe a paraphrase from the book of Matthew chapter 5 from verse 45 to verse 48. Let me just quote what Mahatma Gandhi said. He said, it is easy enough to be friendly to one's friend, but to befriend the one who regards himself as your enemy is the quintessence of true religion. The other is mere business. So if you love those who love you, relate with people in your office, oh, they are my friends, it's just mere business. Let any of them become your enemy. Let any of them do something that hurts you badly. Will you still love them? That is the question. That is the test. He said that is the true religion. Every other thing is mere business. Let's look at what our Lord Jesus Christ said here in the book of Matthew chapter 5 from verse 45. Up to verse 48. Let me point something out here. A lot of people misquote and misinterpret that verse 48. Thereby they say, be ye perfect as your heavenly father is perfect. And they will mean that perfection means sanctification. No. What he's saying is, do likewise the way your God has done, because that is the replica of the image of God, in loving and forgiving others, even if they are your enemy. So that we don't quote out of context. Let's listen very well. And that's what Joseph exhibited to his brother. And now that Lord is reminding you and I on the way he sees sinners and the way he sees those who offended us. If time permits, we'll be looking at the example of David and Saul and several other examples in the scripture. Not to even mention that of Jonah. Continue reading. Matthew chapter 5 from verse 45 to verse 48. Reading from the Message Translation, Message Bible.
When someone gives you a hard time, respond with the energies of prayer. For then you are working out your true selves, your God-created selves. This is what God does. He gives his best, the sun to warm and the rain to nourish, to everyone, regardless the good and bad, the nice and nasty. If all you do is love the lovable, do you expect a bonus? Anybody can do that. If you simply say hello to those who greet you, do you expect a medal? Any run-of-the-mill sinner does that. Verse 48. In a word, what I'm saying is, grow up. You are kingdom subjects. Now live like it. Live out your God-created identity. Live generously and graciously towards others, the way God lives towards you.
Thank you very much. Are we not getting what I'm saying? We decided to read from the Message Translation so that we'll be able to catch the nugget, what we are being told by Lord Jesus Christ there. That look, we should not just relate with people on the basis of business, like they are the people that that greet me. He said, now live as a kingdom subject of the kingdom of God. Live out your God-created identity. Live generously. graciously towards others the way God leads towards you. And remember, we said at the beginning of the series we are with the children on how we let the children grow up with this mindset. In the land of Israel, they will see the children then at home and teach them all this, spelling it out one by one. How you should relate with your fellow human being. My dear listener out there, if you have not been doing it in the past, let's be doing it. Translate it to them, you will meet people, and that's what we do in our family. We tell the children, this is it. Even in the house, if they show any trait that doesn't fall in line with that lover, we say, no, you may be kidding, you may be joking, but look, as a child of God, do this trait. If you notice any unkind attitude in what they do, even to strangers out there, we correct them politely and communicate so that we don't put them off again. So we have to balance it so that they will be able to get the nugget of the message of what we are saying. So my dear listener, God loves you. He cares for you. He is telling you and I this message so that we will be able to understand who we are, subject of the kingdom, what is expecting from us, and how to behave. There's a place that really amuses me. It amazes me how they responded, and it amuses me as well because I laugh at it. You know why I laugh at such things? We see it today in our midst. At times you'll be wondering, do people understand what our Lord Jesus Christ is saying? Do people understand who we should be as his follower when we realize the way we behave, the way we boastfully say we can use God to do this? In fact, some people will even curse others in the name of God. Some people will boastfully say because of the power they have, they will show him. Some people will even say, oh yeah, God will do this to you. Well, I'm not surprised. The reference people make to God is to the idolatrous aspect of God, not the God Jehovah God in the Bible. God with the small g, as is written in letters out there. God as in the idols, not our Heavenly Father. So when they make reference boastfully as in vengeance and things they need to do, it is not to Jehovah. So the example we are looking at in the scripture is what the Lord expects you and I to be doing. In the book of Luke chapter 9, and this is pointing to you that we are not just out of place, it's just a process of you and I getting back on track. The disciples were following our Lord Jesus Christ. And boastfully, some of them were Pharisees before, some of them were Sadducees, some of them belong to different group, but they have seen the light. They are now following our Lord Jesus Christ, but not total transformation has taken place in them. And they got to a place where somebody offended them. In fact, somebody did what they did not expect to our Lord Jesus Christ. And they now felt like, yes, we have the power. After all, we have been loaded with that power, empowered to do anything. And they ask the master, do these people even know the kind of person we are? Do they know who you are? Should we command fire from heaven to consume them? They are constituting themselves to be our enemy. No, we know naturally the Samaritans don't like we people from the south, because they are from the north. They don't like us. But now we show them we have the power. How many times have you or have I shown power to people I can oppress? I say, yes, I will show them who I am. Who are you before God? You only have one life, just few minutes of being alive, which God can take. So that's one thing you and I should be thinking. Our life does not belong to us. It belongs to God. That was the reference Joseph made in relating with his brother who offended him. And he said, look, am I in the position of God? And that's exactly what the disciples were about to do. Let's look at this in the book of Luke chapter 9, from verse 52 to verse 55. The disciple did the opposite of what Joseph did. But Lord Jesus Christ was so apt in correcting them, pointing to them that you don't know the spirit you are made of. The brothers of Joseph did not realize the spirit Joseph was made of. They thought it was the human wicked spirit that was living in them. But Joseph said, my reference is to God. Continue reading.
Verse 52. And sent messengers before his face.
That's our Lord Jesus Christ sent messengers before him. Continue.
And as they went, they entered the village of the Samaritans to prepare for him, but they did not receive him because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, just as Elijah did? But he turned and rebuked them and said, you do not know what manner of spirit you are of.
Thank you. It's a very common thing nowadays for believers to be so boastful. I will show you who I am. In fact, the fire of God as a witch God is the fire of demon you are worshipping. That you keep on saying God will destroy somebody. God doesn't destroy. We are looking, referring to Yahweh, Jehovah God. He doesn't go out to destroy. He goes out to give people opportunity to repent. And if they fail to repent, the repercussion of what they are doing, based on the results of what they are doing, will catch up with them, not God that is all out. If in the midst of what they are doing, they repent, they turn out from their wicked way, God will show that love, welcoming hand for them to go and for them to prosper and succeed. So most of the time, we attribute power that does not come belong to us to ourselves. And because it's becoming a norm, a lot of people are doing it, we think it's right. Lo and behold, if our reference is to our Lord Jesus Christ, we would trace our step. And Lord Jesus Christ told them, he said, look, read that verse 55 again.
But he turned and rebuked them and said, Do you not know what manner of spirit you are of? For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them.
Thank you very much. So, my dear listener, there, our Lord Jesus Christ explained the essence of his mission to the disciple. We often expect the fire of God to destroy our enemy or a calamity to befall the opposition or our accuser as a proof that we are serving a living God. You know, that's the common thing. People will expect evil things to befall somebody that does something against us so that my God will prove himself. My dear listener, I'm sorry. We are following the way of the devil if you are doing that one. Our God doesn't do that one. They now put a word to show that I'm serving a living God. No, 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 no. That is not the living God we are serving. A living God we are serving is what our Lord Jesus Christ has portrayed. And that's what we have in the book of Matthew chapter 5 from verse 45 out of verse 48, where we are told that the God made the sun to shine on the bad and the good, and he gives everyone opportunity to repent. So this thoughts are born, all these thoughts people have are born out of idolatrous approach, whereby an idol will be invoked to intervene or revenge for their followers who might have been offended or oppressed by someone. So what those idol worshippers will do is they go to their shrine and they'll be invoking the spirit to go and oppress for them, to go and intervene for them. That is the mentality a lot of people have brought to Christianity. But Apostle Paul was telling them, no, leave vengeance to God. You are not the one to invoke it. He has a way of dealing with people. And at the end of the day, whatever they might have done, if they repent, the Lord has a way of bringing them back unto himself. And you out there, whatever you have gone through, the Lord has a way of delivering you, even using that calamity, that challenging situation, to move to a higher level when we connect to his teaching, when we allow his own word to guide us. That was what happened to Joseph. Every situation Joseph found himself, even being in the pits, it is said out there that empty pit in the desert is never empty. They have serpents, they have snakes out there, they have a scorpion out there, and they are the big scorpion that within few minutes of being stung by the scorpion, they are dead. But Joseph was there, nothing happened to him. The Lord shut the mouth of the scorpion, of the snakes, and it came out. That was the first miracle. So when the average Israelite refer to Joseph, they refer to the miracle of deliverance from the pits. It's not just a story of a reference, and he was dropped in the pit. From the pit, the Ishmaelites bought him. They took him to Egypt. No, when they mention the pit, an average Israelite will say, wow, that God has able to deliver Joseph from that pit, from the dangerous scorpion and from the snakes. Is able to deliver me. So my dear listener out there, whatever anybody has planned against you to do evil to you, the Lord will continue to deliver you. He will take you from that grave, from that pit, even to glory, from that prison to the palace, in whatever situation. But one thing Joseph did, he connected to that godly trait, the godly mind in him. And as you continue to do it, he will continue to deliver us from our expectation in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Matthew, we are told, pray for your enemy. When they are hungry, give them food. When they are thirsty, give them water. By so doing, you are bringing them to repentance. You are bringing them, winning them over to God. Heaping coal of fire on them. The coal of fire is not to burn them for them to die. We have explained it in the past. Historically, when somebody is won over with love, they will put charcoal in a tray and will be dancing around to exhibit to the whole town like carnival. And you'll be coming behind the enemy that has been made to repent. Everybody will be praising you. Oh, you have used godliness to win the person over to God. By so doing, you have converted the person. That was what is written in the book of Proverbs, and now what Apostle Paul retreated in the book of Romans. So, my dear listener out there, when we have full understanding of the concept in the scripture, will not be misinterpreting and misapplying. So our Lord Jesus warned the disciples, you do not know the spirit you are made of. You are made of the spirit of God. The spirit that dwells in you is not like that of the world, whereby you are looking out for vengeance at all costs. He said, leave them alone. Don't worry. And what did our Lord Jesus Christ do? He went through the longer journey. If he had decided to pass through that town, he can make all of them to be blind. He can make a wall to stand sideways for him to walk through without them seeing him. But he said no. He wanted to demonstrate to the disciples the kind of spirit that lives, dwells in them. Loving spirit. Not vengeful spirit. Not a revenging spirit. It's a spirit of love, doing what you can do to touch life, to portray and reflect the nature of God. We are told that he went through another path to go to the destination where he was going to. On your own, you can still study that book of Luke, chapter 9 from verse 52 to the end. We are quickly going to look at another example before we close tonight in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 24. From verse 4 to verse 6, we read verse 11 and possibly verse 16 to 19. Let me just explain this a little before we go into reading of those chapter. That's the case of David and Saul, whereby David was being waylaid, was being pursued by Saul, who was out to kill him out of rivalry, saying that David has been well loved, appointed, anointed to succeed him, and he was out to kill him at all costs. David had opportunity to avenge and to kill Saul, but when eventually he had that opportunity, when God delivered Saul to his hand, he refrained from killing Saul. But David did something, and God reprimanded him for it. David went and cut the corner of the robe Saul was wearing. He was troubled in the heart. God said, do not attribute this glory to yourself. You might be wondering, this is very simple. Somebody has been trying to kill you, and you find the person sleeping there. It's whoever sees the other person that killed first. And David remembered the godly thing in him. He did not go ahead to kill Saul, but he went and cut the edge of his robe. Cutting the edge of his robe means the throne has belonged to me. I'm now king. But God is saying, give glory to me. You are not the one that did it by yourself. You shouldn't have done that one. And that was one thing that really displeased God. My dear listener out there, you might say, I did not do anything wicked. I did not pay back. I did not do this. But there may be some subtle things that you might have done, which really did not portray or reflect the true love of God. And that was why God corrected corrected David there. Let's read together from verse 4 to 6, 11, and then the next few verses. Continue reading.
Then the men of David said to him, this is the day of which the Lord said to you, behold, I will deliver your enemy into your hand, that you may do to him as it seems good to you.
I like that. You know, when you see people wailing on, just pause there. When you see people wailing on, they say, this is opportunity you have. God has delivered your enemy to your hand. You know, when you listen to the voice of men, you will not be able to, you'll be blocked from hearing the voice of God. But if you continue reading, let's see what David did there.
And David arose and secretly cut off a corner of Saul's robe. Now it happened afterward that David's heart troubled him.
Thank you. Just pause there. Thank you very much. You know, ordinarily David is somebody with the mind of God. But because of the advice he had from the people, he went ahead. He didn't go ahead to kill. People say, I have an opportunity for you to kill the man. He see him sleeping. But he went and cut the edge of the robe. Intent to show that, yes, the kingdom has been delivered to my hand. The reign, the throne is now mine. But verse 11.
Moreover, my father, see the corner of your robe in my hand, for in that I cut off the corner of your robe and did not kill you. Know and see that there is neither evil nor rebellion in my hand. I have not sinned against you, yet you hunt my life to take it.
Thank you. Look at what David did. Humanly speaking, we say, oh yeah, he's saying the right thing. Truly, he told Saul, look, you wanted to kill me. I did not kill you. I've caught the edge of the rope. But what did God do? God corrected David. He said, you shouldn't have done it. I'm not happy with what you have done. The Lord is telling you and I something. You and I need to go beyond human expectation. Connect to the expectation of our Heavenly Father. We may not be able to connect this tonight. When you listen to the voice of man, you will take the wrong step. But we are looking at what God is saying. People said, aha, opportunity for you. But David did a little bit of it, but not fully. And God said, you don't know my nature. And Lord Jesus told the disciples, said, you don't know the spirit you are made of. This is the way God sees those who have offended us. This is the way God sees sinners. And as we are followers of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are to follow his way. We are to imbibe his culture, everything about him. That really now makes us to be Christian. Miniature Christ. That's the meaning of Christian. Little Christ. Miniature Christ. Christ-like people. Are you ready to follow his way? And if anyone has done something against you that hurts you, even done so, cause some damage, tonight healing has come unto you in Jesus' name. If Amen. You have lost a job, lost a position, lost a contract as a result of what somebody had done, tonight restoration is coming and multiple fold in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the Lord is telling you and I, tonight you are being empowered to do exactly like he did. Telling the disciple, you don't know the spirit you are made of. And if you are there tonight, you have some healing challenges in your life, expecting healing from God. Tonight, healing has come upon you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, thank you, Lord, for that you've done. Thank for you, in Lord. Jesus Christ's name, I pray.
Amen. You can link us on our email address, kingdomlifefamily@yahoo.com, or through our producer, Taiwo Omoshule, Echo 89.7 FM, Latif Jakondewe, Agidingbi, Ikeja. A sound engineer on this program has been Sonayo Joseph. Remain blessed.
Thank you very much, my dear listener out there. I'm Jumi Adetoye Shonlagunju. Please let others see Christ in you. Obey the law of the land. Use your seat belt. When you are driving, it could save life. Use your crash helmet or car rider out there and obey the traffic light. God loves you. Obedience to the law of the land is obedience to the word of God. Be part of this program next week, Sunday by 8:05. Remain blessed.
Righteousness. Peace and joy. Righteousness, peace, war and joy in the Holy Ghost. Righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's the kingdom of God.
Everybody sing
righteousness, peace. Joy in the Holy Ghost.
Oh,
righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's the kingdom of God. Don't you wanna be a part of the kingdom? Don't you wanna be a part? Oh, don't you wanna be a part of the kingdom?
Come on,
come on, everybody. Don't you wanna be a part? Oh, don't you wanna be a part?